So please start thinking about it, the change of methods of work, the threats and everything which is entailed in Europe is going to, it's also creating some sort of competition between the people who work in such precarious conditions. So we have to work on that and query the whole situation. And we don't have to look at them in a sexy and attracting way, because the question, the main issue on the, in the core of the matter is the people who work themselves. So I decided to choose this issue after two different documents, a series of articles in Mediapart, the fights of uberization, and they actually queried four battles, the battle of Deliveroo in Belgium, and Lisa can talk about that, and Spanish cleaning ladies who had full-time jobs with one specific employer, the hotel or whatever, and now, today, they're all working for subcontractors, and I mean, they have working times for the day, for the hour, whatever. It's, of course, their conditions are very bad. Then Uber in London, and how the taxis in London, the Uber taxis in London, have actually been able to win legal battles with the council and training employment. Who said no, they are not freelance people, they have a normal relationship, employer, worker, and they need paid holidays and so on. Deliveroo also, I think, enjoyed some victory in court. What about the legal battle they won, or the legal decision? So Lisa can talk about that later. And the fourth article is on the those people who work for Amazon, especially in Germany. But basically, the issue which is something which I was interested in is that those German people who worked for Amazon have started with winning some battles, and today they go to other countries, such as Poland and so on, so that they want to influence other countries as well, so that the people who work for Amazon start representing a collective force of workers and eventually win battles. And the end is the description of an essay by three sociologists working on the precarious classes in France particularly. And apart from what people in politics tend to dream about, that the popular classes, workers, have disappeared. It's not the case, and Europe does not address those people, and certainly does not have any solutions to bring them. And so that was my first thought. That's the English version. And the Green European Journal is it's not the latest, but it deals with the transformation of work in Europe. And it's a series of articles on the gig economy, and they refer to robots replacing men in the future. Is there going to be any work in the future, and so on? But there are also several articles on the specific articles on the specific issue of those people who work more and more under a freelance status or whatever, being paid per hour or whatever, with a negative establishment from the researchers. The debate today is, are those new ways of working, is it just a way for the employers to get rid of all the obligations and constraints that they had to comply with, who managed, because the previous fights used to establish a basis for work and conditions. And is it just a threat that tomorrow we're going back to what used to be and being paid per hour, or are there opportunities in such new methods? Do some people find something in it? Are they happy with it? In this journal, there's the interview of a president the chairman of a very strong German trade union. And it is, he says that it is very negative, he said, but there are also some young people who wish to work like that. And so that's an argument which is also used by Deliveroo and Uber, because they say that some people enjoy that and they choose that sort of work. So we have two speakers, Lisa, who works for a cooperative called Smart in Brussels. And her name is mentioned in one of the articles in Mediapart. And this cooperative started offering to be an intermediary between the employer and the freelance people, so that enforcing the employers to give them established conditions and reasonable conditions. It's a lobby as well. And for 6 years, you've also been implanted in Paris, and Jesse works in a Dutch trade union for young people, young workers.
And he
also helped people in supermarkets, in fighting supermarkets. They're also a political lobby, more or less, and how to put such issues in the public debate, and also how to support the fight on the territory. Lisa, can you start, please? My name is Lisa. I work for Smart. I've been working for 7 years, approximately. I've been asked to talk about Uberization, so I give you the more or less the environment, so that you know that in which context Smart operates and what we're trying to do. Because there's not a lot of time, so I'm going to give a general view on certain things, and maybe it's not going to be more or less, we can talk later on about the differences rather than in my presentation. When we talk about Uberization and the platform economy, we're talking about an economy which is fairly young. And you're going to see that in all those new platforms, emerging platforms, some of them are trying to Uberize work, to organize the ways work is being organized in our society. And when you look at those platforms, you can see that there are three different categories of them. One sort of platform connects people. If you're looking for a gardener, for instance, you can go to such platforms and find one. Then you have platforms which are going to organize new services like delivery or transport services. And then there's a third category, and I'm not going to detail that because it's not a specialization I know about. And it's basically all digital work for those people who are going to come into play when the new artificial intelligence fails, and they're going to do what the computers cannot do yet. And this is a workforce which is competing throughout the world on the platform. Those workers disappear completely from normal way, and they work on such platforms from their home, and they are cut from any social work, any social links which we find in the work surroundings. Then if you look at all the workers in the platforms, you can see that globally they all compete against each other strongly, because they are given marks by the clients, and their performance is also gives them a mark according to the platform's judgment. And the platform was created to avoid social links between the various workers, so that you can see that the worker is going to be at the service of the platform. Technology doesn't serve the human, it's the other way around. And what is very problematic here as well is that the human, whatever deals with whatever affects human resources, is going to be delegated to algorithms. And in fact, all the decisions are taken by the algorithm, and the human factor has disappeared completely.
and
those solutions are binary solutions, and they tend to want to simplify complex questions and issues. And such platforms, which are supposed to be simple intermediaries, in fact, they try to get away from any responsibility from entrepreneurship. And when you undertake something, it's in a special territory with people in particular, and it is under the umbrella of digitalization, and they claim, such enterprises just claim, oh, we're just in intermediates and we have no responsibility in anything. It's a bit problematic for the categories we saw in the beginning, and those people were really rooted in real life, and they just organize work, which is well known. Everybody knows what a gardener is, everybody knows what a delivery man is, and so in fact there's absolutely no reason why such people, which are part of our daily life, cannot enjoy and benefit from whatever has been put down before. And at the same time, we can see that there's underlying is the idea that the work as we knew it is now over, and there's a question for more flexibility in work. We all want to turn around the situation of unemployment, and we have to think about that. There are many opportunities to take, but as we understand, wage earning seems to be over, so people have to be enabled to go into entrepreneurship, and that's how we started with a startup system, that everybody has to be an entrepreneur, everybody has to start his own society or whatever. But in fact, it appears clearly that it's much easier to say than actually do. Everybody cannot access to the status and the situation of being independent, as used to be the case in the beginning. And to enable more people to access entrepreneurship, what was done is that entrepreneurship was simplified with new status, such as being an independent worker, and there are far less constraints. In France, you have the self-entrepreneurship in Job Act in England, zero-hour contract in England, and in Belgium, we just invented collaborative economy income. And all those contracts have in common is that they are out of the regulations. There's hardly any taxes. And the other side is that there's, of course, no social security. They do not contribute. So before, the collective situation was looking after such workers, and there used to be a mutualized system to protect their careers over time. But today, the responsibility lies on the particular people, and they're already precarized, and now they're even more precarized. And so it is, we see it as a considerable violence, social violence, and building the world of today, of tomorrow, and the future on such a logic, with the main competition between the various workers, is a serious problem because it is obsolete, it's getting old, and we are building the future of work on an ideology and thought of the past. So really, we have to reinvent social contracts and solidarity system. It seems very complicated, but it's already done. That's the good news. Now, the company I work for is smart. It is interested in the future of work and in how to reorganize this world of a flexible, more and more flexible work working world, and most people need more flexibility in their jobs. But we are a shared company, and we, in fact, have been working for 20 years. So we were not just an anecdote. We've been in the world for 20 years, over in 9 countries, and 200 million amount of money we work with. The principle is similar to the sharing cars, but what we share is in the company is much better because it is completely stupid in our eyes to have to create one's own legal structure and constantly reinvent how to declare the amount I earn and all the administrative documents. And so we want to share with other people, and that's what SMART does. We started 20 years ago with in the artistic world, which was the first one to be faced with such new world, and we opened our services later on for freelance or self-entrepreneur as we meet them today. And 50% of our revenues come from the service sectors and 50% from the wider world of the wider artistic world. And each time somebody works with us, our business is going to be used as if it was the business of that person, and working regularly, that person is going to be a member of our cooperative, and it becomes a common good. We're going to mutualize the risks linked to individual entrepreneurship, and it means that people sometimes find it difficult to get paid, and we can guarantee that they're going to be paid 7 days after the end of their mission, and it's our business to try to get the invoices paid, which is too complicated for individuals. And when people are going to work, we are going to give them a sort of wage earner contract, because it is today the best social protection. And then we have another service to help to support the training, such as microcredits. But I have no time to go into all the details. In general, what we want to do is to try to bring the collective back into individualized career paths, and we just want to establish some sort of strength through this collective system. What does it mean in everyday life? And when we're talking about Uberization, for us, it is the example of Deliveroo, because SMART found one day to another all the delivery men from Deliveroo, and in our systems, it was a sort of more or less an accidental meeting. But on site, in the field, we actually found about 15 delivery men who joined per day. So that was new, because we never had such a strong requirement. Sorry. And we wondered what it was all about, and we found that two companies sent us their workers because we were asked to play the employer's part. We discussed with the delivery men, and we found out that there was a subordination link between the enterprise and what we do. Our service is not adapted to that. So we discussed with Lucienne, who looks after the independent, and she said that we are used to sending them because so that's a service looking after the independents, because we know very well that they find it absolutely impossible to assume that independent statue, because it involves so much money for what they earn. So that workforce changes all the time. So it's not a entrepreneurship over long term. And in fact, we discussed with them, we told them that we're not really interested in such workers and that it was their role to take them. But they didn't want to take them on. And we said, okay, we agree, but if we decide to keep them, you have to pay them, to give them the minimum legal pay, and they have to have a contract for at least 3 hours a day, so that if they mobilize for the platform, they have to be paid. And it's also normal to pay at least part of them for the costs which they encounter with their own phone, their bicycles, and so on. And so we set up a prevention plan, and we tried to raise awareness on that delivery man job. It's a very dangerous job because most of them ride a bike when it's raining, for instance, and the system wants them to ride faster and faster. So we made sure that they get an insurance, all of them, and they all have a helmet for free. But it saves lives. So, and we were quite happy because, but we were happy, but not enough because we had negotiated for the minimum. But we knew that it was the worst of two evils for those workers, and it's not normal that in our territories, we accept that sort of a situation, but we could not negotiate more with such enterprises. So we went to see the trade unions to ask them for help, because it's their skill to actually militate on their emerging market. And we worked together with the collective of the delivery men and coursiers, big couriers, because they know better what they need. And we started to think and work on working convention, and it's already far advanced, but we were quite unlucky because the Belgian government made some announcement saying that they're going to invent a new way to declare that collaborative economy, and deliverers started being afraid because they realized that we had a started a process which would end. So they decided that in from January 2018, none of their workers could work with Smart. So that entailed strikes, and the government started to show some interest, serious interest for that sort of issue. And they wanted to find out if there was a subordination link. And since January 2018, we haven't been working with the delivery men of Deliveroo, because, but we're still worried because we don't know what sort of insurance they have in this working world. I can actually work for an hour on Deliveroo because it was quite interesting because they had sort of bankruptcy in France and they became self-entrepreneurs. But then in Belgium, all the students were not paid for a month, and it is very, very important because if they work, if those people work, it's just to fill their fridge and pay the rent. In Belgium, our enterprise, our society mutualizes everything and mutualizes the risk. So we paid for the workers. That amounted to 400,000 euros, and we can do that because we have never distributed any dividends, and whatever we earn is reinvested in our local communities and to prevent that sort of risk. We would like that not to happen too often, of course, but at least we can offer that that sort of service. So to conclude, I spent some time on everything that's not working on in the collaborative economy, because I believe in collaborative economy quite a lot, and in the technological tools to face the tomorrow's challenges which are linked to ecology, the lack of work, more social justice, and so on. But I think that the mistake we are currently making is that we are in the age of speeding up, and we all think we're going not to be able to jump on the bandwagon of innovation. And so everything seemed easy and fun, and nobody wondered who pays what and for what and how and so on. So we now realize that it's not a very good idea, and we got lost in that idea and collectively, and we also realized that we were lost in that startup culture. Whatever is being told about startup is not exact. When you try to find out what how a digital company is set up and what the social purpose is, it's very often far less glamour and far less interesting than the actual entrepreneur businesses which we can see in everyday life. And if in Smart we can do what we like, it's because we digitalized a great deal of what we can, and our own tool, digital tool, made us, enabled us to grow as we do on our own, but we try to compensate the lacks of the startups. But we have decided to use the funds and whatever we do for the human being. And we hear less about the various things which are being used, and those businesses are far more complex and have economic economies which are old-fashioned, and it seems to be against that day when everything is fast and so on. But we can see that the politicians are getting tired of what is fast, and we hear about European Center for Social Rights, and you can see with the data protections, you can see that the trade unions are starting to show some interest for uberization, because they realized that it was not some sort of anecdotic and temporary workers, but people who are actual workers who need to be protected, and people, workers are trying to find some collective situation. And I'm quite confident we're going to find new ways, and there's a very active movement. It's a cooperatism platform. Smart used to be, or is still very involved, and we have been for 3 years, and we're trying to study the benefits of digital platforms, and what about doing the creating a cooperative on all the digital platforms and create something in common and invest in local economy, and you find academics, social entrepreneurs like SARS and so on. So I more or less covered everything.
That was a very interesting story about the background.
C'était une histoire très intéressante quant au contexte de l'ubérisation.
And I could also cover it in Holland, in the Netherlands, but it is quite similar. Instead, I will focus on how we, as a trade union, I'm from the trade union in Holland, how we combated and how we are still combating the uberization of work in the Netherlands. So a while ago, I think about 2 years, I'm looking at you, but you don't know either, we decided that, well, there might be a problem coming up soon, because Deliveroo, the one that was most high profile in this, decided, well, we now have a lot of riders in our employ, they work for us, but we are going to change that, because we want profits, we're a big company. So the next thing they did, on January 1st, 2018, they decided they would make every single employee, every single rider, they would give them the choice, but everyone would have to anyway. They were now forced to become autonomous workers, freelancers. So what we did about this is, a while back, we started something called the Riders Union. And the Riders Union was a part of our union that focused exclusively on the campaign of knocking down Deliveroo and changing what they were trying to do to change the labor market. And this is not just on Deliveroo. This is part of a symbol of fighting the platform economy as a whole in the Netherlands. When we started the Writers Union, we got a lot of funds from the big union. For context, the union in the Netherlands has about 1 million members on a labor market of 8 million workers. So it is the general union that put a lot of funds into one single sector. So this is not very little when it comes to the resources you would put towards a fight. So we put a lot of organizers, we put a lot of, well, I don't really know the English term, Bestuurder? Yeah, a lot of union leaders were put forward to this campaign to help them get started, help the workers get organized. A lot of protests later, we got media attention, we got attention in politics. I think the Labour Party took up a lot of, put up a fight in the parliament, and soon after the Green Party and the Socialist Party also followed. And after a while, we also decided, well, we have this one guy, Sietze, who is our metaphor for the entire branch. We are going to sue Deliveroo and force them to put Sietze and other people into normal employment contracts. Now, earlier this year, we lost that lawsuit, and the assignment was pretty simple of what the judge said we had to do. It all came down to the law allows this, to have freelancers that work for one single company rather than what freelancers used to do, where they worked for different companies and earned a lot of money doing it. The law said it was possible, at least that's what the judge said. So the next step would be, and the judge said this too, this is a political fight. So it's going to have to be changed in the law. And that's a good assignment for us in the Netherlands, but also in Europe. This is definitely not a national problem, especially with the platform economy. We have companies popping up like Uber, who is of course the namesake of the entire concept, Lyft, Deliveroo. We'll probably see a lot of different companies adopting a similar way of working and similar way of employing people. And those are mostly going to be multinationals, because it's easier than ever to be active in more than one country. If you work in Holland, you might as well work in Germany, because, you know, it's right around the border. Not really that big of a deal. So in order to solve this problem, a good way to start might be in Europe. Put the European Commission on it. Put the European Parliament on it. Because as the judge said, it's no longer a matter of enforcing the law, it's now a matter of changing the law. And that's not something a labor union can do, well, not directly at least. And organizing freelancers who have zero security is difficult for a labor union in the first place, especially when it's a pan-European problem. So that's why we also thought there was value in going here today. And speaking to, in this case, the French, and speaking with the French Greens, which is all of you, of course, on how to solve this problem on a European scale. Because at the end of the day, the thing people want most is to be able to afford rent, and to be able to be sure that you can afford rent in 10 months as well, and in 5 years. Rather than just tomorrow. And I think that is what this fight is mostly about.
Thank you. Just before I give the floor to the people in the audience. Do you work? I would have a very specific question in just after your intervention. Do you work with other trade unions in other countries to try to fight on a pan-European level against this pan-European phenomena?
The thing we do most right now is national. All within Holland, working together with different political parties, Labour, Socialists, Greens, to combat this problem internationally, not so much. And I think that is something where we absolutely can improve.
Est-ce que déjà il y aurait des questions?
Are there any questions?
Des interventions, si
or
vous
does anybody want to speak or say anything? Okay. I have no one to pass the microphone.
Bonjour, merci pour ce que j'ai entendu, malheureusement j'arrive en retard.
Ma question
porte sur ce que vous appelez économie collaborative.
What do you call a collaborative economy?
Est-ce qu'il serait pas temps d'arrêter de l'appeler économie collaborative dans la mesure où d'ailleurs il y a plein de chercheurs qui ont commencé à l'appeler autrement?
Because it's some researchers have d'exploitation organisée par des plateformes
et c'est très différent des formes d'auto-organisation. Et quand vous dites
and it's very different from collaborative economy.
Pour le coup, autant la plateforme cooperativism peut être envisagée comme une économie collaborative puisque les gens collaborent à quelque chose qui leur appartient et dont ils ont encore maîtrise.
As something that people still have control over. But when we're talking about Deliveroo, these are clearly indirect work for employees. So perhaps we should call it a different name because we're enjoying cheap delivery and cheap taxis, and of course it's all magical and fairy tale-like, but I think that we should sensitize people to the fact of what's going on behind the scenes. So we should stop perceiving this as something positive. Thank you, Valérien. Is there another question before we answer? And there'll be other opportunities. So this is a follow-up of what has just been said. Of course, we have to talk about taxes because some platforms are machines that earn money and pay no taxes or very little and don't participate to the common equipment and everything that we need for public services. I'll have the third question now.
Oui, bonjour. Merci pour les éclairages.
Yes, thank you very much. I just wanted to know if we could larger the scope of the debate of uberization and platforms because we are really going into legal subordination and the rights of workers. Because we're going towards a commercial subordination whereby work is not regulated.
Et finalement, la responsabilité du donneur d'ordre, de la responsabilité sociale du donneur d'ordre.
It is, of course, the responsibility of the person making decisions and giving out work.
De sous-traitance exacerbée, individualisée.
This is an exaggerated example of big companies where human resources don't manage the relationships with their employees, but there are factories, for example, where there are various employees from different companies or different countries that come and work and are managed on a diverse level. So we have independent and freelancers now who have to fend for themselves.
Alors sur le terme, je suis d'accord.
Right, regarding the terms and the first questions, I totally agree.
D'ailleurs, il y a pas mal de gens qui réfléchissent à ces
questions-là. And in fact, many people are considering this at the moment, changing the term, and they are writing articles about this and having conferences about this and discussing what collaborative economy really is and there are other names or ways of calling it that emerge. But this takes a lot of time because we've been
living this narrative for a long time, and perhaps we need to change it, but that may take time. But the thinkers and the researchers are, of course, considering this, and they're trying to build a new narrative around what's going on. I think that the collaborative economy, as a term, is going to exist for another few years, because we're used to using it.
On sent quand même déjà que dans cette terminologie-là,
within this terminology, there is some kind of suspicion that already exists, and we're already wary of collaborative economy. And that's how and why we see a shift in the vocabulary today in the people who are committed to changing things. Some platforms are not boasting their collaborative economy as such, because perhaps within a few years they'll want to be considered collaborative as well, and we'll have to change our narrative. So this is semantics, and it's a play on words, it's part of the marketing, it's also academic, and it belongs to the companies as well. So we permanently have to update, of course, the use of terms and bring people back to something that is more exact. But of course, in the meantime, we have to move forward. So if people understand that term and know what we mean, then we use the term because everybody knows what we're talking about. If I talk about cooperativism, people don't understand what I'm talking about and are not so aware. So I like the previous term, and I like to maintain that collaborative economy. And of course, discourse cannot always be pure and exact, because it's difficult to convey our ideas. Now, about taxation, yes, that's very interesting, because vocabulary is also involved in here. For a long time, the collaborative economy and crowdfunding or Deliveroo used words that were new for companies that pretended that they were new. So if we take Deliveroo and we remove the sexy name of startup, and we see that it's just a delivery service, and we know exactly how people have to be paid and how the tax system works for these delivery companies. But when we change the vocabulary that is linked to the subordination, then immediately where it's a whole different ball game. And here they talk about onboarding, and they don't talk their staff, they don't call their staff, but they call them drivers or riders. And they have a logo rather than a uniform. And so there's a lot going on in the vocabulary that creates an illusion of lack of legislation. And this also exists in something that is less serious. For example, crowdfunding. If we look at crowdfunding in a rational manner, then we see that 90% of the time it's pre-sale. And we know how pre-sale is sold. We have to pay taxes on it, VAT. But between two individuals, there's something going on as well. So if we look at the vocabulary that is related to crowdfunding, there is a counterpart. There is a present, that is, there is a gift involved in the crowdfunding, and that's also a sale. But this moved forward very fast. It was invested in digitalization, and it appeared very new. People got very involved and didn't really understand what was going on, and we're in another illusion. Now, of course, we must not change things, but we have to be fair and we have to be honest about what's going on and what we are setting up. The last question regarding subordination, I think that we need to consider work outside the subordination link. I don't think that we need to maintain that link always.
qu'autant les droits sociaux.
But we mustn't abolish social rights.
On a réussi à organiser le travail et on a réussi à.
It's important to remember that we invented social security, that we have organized work, paid work, and protection for workers, and that's important for a lot of people. And we must base ourselves on what we know in order to create new social contracts for tomorrow. And we don't have to maintain a subordination link, but we can. So there's no binary solution for this question. But there are some practices that are very anchored. And we often give out work to other companies in an unclear manner without really knowing what the contract is, who is doing what, and who is responsible for what. We are all equal in the face of an accident or illness, and it is logical that we should all collectively be able to have some kind of social security that is common to everybody, regardless of the contract that we have. For our job. So we have to come back to a collective situation and create something intelligent together like we have already done many a time. And I think that the policymakers and social entrepreneurs have to get together. I have put a lot of hope in the new generation because I think that there are a lot of people who are interested in the social and solidary economy. And I think that a lot of people are trying to create jobs that have an importance for them and make sense. And we are already old when we talk about digitalization. Some people were born into it and are trying to make sense of what's going on. And I'm sure that if we educate them properly and that we stop telling them stories about entrepreneurship and startups as the stories are told in business schools today, I think that we can bring back social justice and create a society where value is distributed much more equally. Thank you.
So coming back to the first question about the use of words, the words that we use in Holland have shifted from before we used the word deeleconomie, which means sharing economy. And that is, of course, a very positive frame on what this is, but now we have more and more switched to a different term, platform economy, which covers a completely different meaning that you are conveying with the word that you're saying. Whenever we communicate to the outside world or internally, we do pay attention to which words we use. Personally, I dislike the Dutch word for employer and employee, for example, well, in Dutch it is werkgever and werknemer. Werkgever means work granter, and werknemer means work taker. And that's a frame in which it is said subliminally that the people that are in charge, that those are very divine and give work to, you know, to the commons, to us, and I really dislike that word because, well, frankly, they need us. So I would prefer the term worker and the term, well, the Dutch term for boss, because it is more balanced in term to what the power structure really is. And in the same way, we changed for ourselves the word that we use for the platform economy, because it's about platforms. It's not about sharing. It's not about some person offering a service or some person taking a service and them coming together. Sometimes it's like that. But in most ways, and in ways that it is being abused a lot, it is not. It is not like that. It's just a company offering a service, but doing so by cutting costs, by making people insecure in their existence and being able to, for example, pay rent, pay their phone, pay internet, pay whatever. On terms of taxation, I think Lisa covered most of it. I also didn't really understand the question. It was lost in translation a little bit, just as the question on subordination was. So I'm afraid I can't really answer that question unless you're willing to rephrase it.
And on subordination, do you want to have a word on that? Or?
Well, I didn't really understand the question.
Sur la fiscalité, je pense que là,
regarding taxation, I think it's a question that is more political.
La problématique, elle n'est pas que pour les travailleurs individuellement dans leurs conditions de vie, elle est du coup pour la société, workers, parce qu'effectivement, avec ce manque de fiscalité, ce manque d'argent qui rentre pour le service public, c'est la société en entier qui aujourd'hui se trouve en mise en danger, puisque on ne peut plus faire entrer
les entreprises traditionnelles, on avait clairement... And with traditional companies, of course, we knew exactly how they paid taxes, why, and where the money was going, and how they were participated. Now, of course, tax evasion has always existed, and traditional companies always find a way to not pay their taxes. But at least before, these companies knew that they had to hide the fact they weren't paying taxes. Now, companies don't even have to hide that anymore because they have no taxes, there's no system for them to pay taxes. So I think that this is a political issue that we're going to have to confront.
On commence à beaucoup attaquer ce type
so we know that we are attacking these companies on a European level. We are working on GAFAs, the large internet companies. And we are going to have to think about how companies are avoiding taxes, social benefits, paying social welfare, etc.
I had a question. Vous répondez à ceux qui disent mais aujourd'hui,
what do you
des jeunes,
think about people who say that young people want to work differently and so you are being too traditional and young people want more flexibility, they want to change jobs regularly, they want more freedom. Is this true? And do we have to adapt to this stance?
So I get this question a lot, especially in my own country, where this is a question that journalists will easily ask. I usually respond with the simple phrase of, if that were true, we wouldn't have a writers' union, except we do. But we can, this is a more, this is a setting where they aren't looking for a single quote, so we can go into it a little bit further. A lot of young people that work for companies like Deliveroo and other platform economy companies are students. They don't have a lot of monthly things that they have to pay. They don't have a lot of bills that stay the same every month. They don't have children that need to go to school, that need food. So it doesn't really matter if you earn less money and you work less in March than you did in February. It doesn't really matter all that much. However, more and more young people are finding out that the moment that you do want to work and you do have rents to pay, this does start mattering. Especially when it comes to insurances. You mentioned that insurances were a big problem where Deliveroo, when they hired people as freelancers, they wouldn't have to pay insurances. For example, if you fall off your bike while delivering a pizza to somebody, that it would be your problem rather than your employer's problem. And the more this information and these situations are addressed in the media and in the public, the more young people have started to care about their contracts. For example, we are currently working on a supermarket campaign where people, young people, at first, when we talk to them, they would say, well, I think it's fine, I get paid plenty for my age because, well, there's a collective agreement between the unions and the companies. However, when we talk about what they're missing out on, I mean, companies aren't paying them enough like they're supposed to. But when we tell them what they're missing out of, they do start caring. And it suddenly does matter. It is mostly a problem of a combination of problems where it comes to not quite needing security yet, and at the same time not knowing what kind of security is considered normal.
Moi, j'aurais tendance à dire ça, si Deliveroo et Uber arrivent.
I think that if Deliveroo and Uber can do what they do, is because they are. This is based on a truth and a possibility. There's an opening. So I think that the narration regarding entrepreneurship is something real, and it hasn't just emerged out of nowhere. More and more people.
Développer un certain nombre de savoir-faire et
develop a certain number of know-hows, and they want to be able to earn money through these skills. And they don't want a linear way of working. Artists, for example, are going to do communication on the side, and they are also going to do graphic design and not work throughout the summer, for example. It's something that was already very present in the artistic community because artists work on a seasonal basis very often. Some contracts in France, for example, have a special chat status when they work in the theater and cinema. And it's something that exists and something that young people want to experience when they just finish school and want to access the creative world. We're talking about people who work as translators and other independent fields, such as graphic designers, etc., and they want to adapt their working time to their private reality. But it's not because they want this flexibility that they don't want the security that is linked to work. And where there's a gap today is that we are inciting everybody to become an entrepreneur, but we are not teaching them how to do it in a secure way. So people are going to go to communication school or art school or even become an engineer and think it's great to become an entrepreneur, create your own company, but we're never going to tell them how to do it. We're not going to teach them what VAT is. We're not going to teach them about contributing to social benefits, and before they come into our office, they have no idea what social benefits cost, what it costs to work, and how you have to contribute to the paid work system. And it's kind of a slap in the face when they realize that. I think that people need to be sensitized to this. I think that people are going to have to give up thinking that they're going to have one contract and one employer throughout their lives. And I think that we have to start considering and thinking about how we can adapt this change and how we teach people to become entrepreneurs in a safe manner. And I think that the answer to this is collectivity, and that collectively we are responsible for all the entrepreneurs and enabling people to work in good conditions. So I think that we can use all sorts of cooperatives. SMART, the one I work for, is just one example. And there are many political people who are thinking about the notion of work, what work is, and questioning that and how it functions. I'm a woman, and if I have a child, of course, I have to take care of my child, and I'm just a mother. But if I hand my child over to you, you are going to be employed to take care of my child, and you have a job to take care of my child. That's very different. So we have to think about work and consider what it really means and what we are paying and how we are paying and why we are paying people. If we think about care, for example, everything we do for old people, why is it that when a member of of the family takes care of an old person,
there is no remuneration
involved. Whereas if we hire someone to take care of the same person, then of course that person is going to be paid. So we have to redefine what work is, how we collectively create around work, and how we adapt society to all these new ways of working and all these companies that are going to continue working with subordination, because it's something that we know how to do and something we know how to manage. We are interested in new positions, new professions, and how we can cater for these and give people the capability of working in safe ways.
One small nuance on this story that I would like to add from a labor union perspective is the difference between people that have specific skills in which being a freelancer is beneficial to yourself and to society as a whole. Graphics designers are often hired as freelancers because they have one small job to do with one company, and then they go to a different company and work with them as their clients. However, when we talk about Uber and when we talk about Deliveroo, 9 times out of 10, it is not something that you would otherwise call a freelance situation. It is a situation in which people want to work like a regular job, but they're hired as if they were freelancers. And I think this is a very important distinction to make when we're talking about this, which is completely different from what you mentioned, like people in the arts that want to work, for example, in a certain season, they want to do a certain kind of work, and then in the summer they just want to do nothing, and or something like that with their own work times. But a lot of times this is not the reality of freelance work, and I just really wanted to add that distinction.
And I totally agree, and to add to that is just saying it's low-skilled work as well, and there's no upskilling going on, and there's no they do not take care of anything that they should be taking care if they were subcontracting it. So I totally agree. It's just the question is really broad, and we're talking about the future of work. In the case of Uber and Deliveroo, totally agree that they should just do what they are supposed to do. They're the employer, so they just should take on their responsibilities. And the problem with the startup culture is that they could position themselves as simple intermediates. And that's, again, the story that is not told in the right way, and that's where government and legislation needs to kick in. But that doesn't mean that work itself is not in transformation, and if they manage to get away with what they are currently doing is because they know that work is being transformed, and so they take the new narrative to make it their own. But they are very much based on an old school way of setting up a business, and they should comply to the existing regulation. So we agree.
Oui, donc on va reprendre trois questions.
I'm going to take another 3 questions.
Thank you. So there is a view that privatization expanded so rapidly because it provided an alternative to consumers, that provided a more cost-friendly option. And there were even some cases, I think, in the United States where people wanted to go to hospital for emergency. In the United States, there is no national health system. If you do not have a private insurance, it would cost them hundreds of dollars to get an ambulance to take them to the hospital. So even on those cases, they used Uber taxis, although it was, of course, pointed out to them that Uber has no training in healthcare and they might be at risk. So my question is whether you have any reactions from consumer rights groups saying that you are trying to limit an option for consumers that appears to be friendly towards, at least from a cost point of view.
Okay.
Oui, vous avez insisté sur le fait que les plateformes were
at the end of the day intermediaries who were making a benefit out of everything, a profit. But the client is also a profiteer. He also has a responsibility in the whole system. So my question is, what are you actually doing?
Qu'est-ce que vous pensez qu'on pourrait faire pour
could be done, according to you, to raise awareness in the customers, in the purchasers of the service, their share of responsibility, which they have to bear, because they're giving the orders. We are the users. And we're going to take another three, and then we stop.
Oui, bonjour. Parce que professionnellement, je suis inspecteur du travail en France.
I'm a work inspector in France, and in fact, the questions are very interesting, because I just want to shed some light on the fact that whatever the political power in place in France, with 7 million people who are unemployed, there's absolutely no political will to fight against deregulation, against liberal deregulation, because it's a form of adaptation of capitalism to the fight of 1968. Everybody is aware of that, and they have a program which is being actually the rich are going to are winning it because, in fact, the fight between the various classes is putting the various workers into competition. First of all, between the wage earners, we saw in France, we're very happy about Saint-Nazaire. He's very proud to be able to make lovely. Cruise liners, but in fact they're subcontractors from India, and the conditions, their work conditions are absolutely horrible, and they just trample the social rights. And now there's a new stage with the digitalization of platforms, so that they can actually put into competition various workers, like a German entrepreneur. And it is very interesting to have the answer from the Belgium company that something like that is not as developed in France, probably because the social link is the social report is too different, and our trade unions are too weak. And at the same time, we were talking about the people who work, the artists, for instance, and in France, all the people who contribute pay for that situation of the artists. But it is a supplementary cost, and probably because we accept in France that we are willing to pay for those. And it's regularly put on the table because by the employers. It is not a very simple question. But what I wanted to say as well is that indeed, according to what you said, there's a big difference between the social forces and whichever the government, they're ready to try just any experience, even if it's absolutely legal, as long as the figures, the unemployment figures go down a little bit. So some form of regulation is very important, and they all want to boast about unemployment figures going down. But in fact, we have people in who live in poor neighborhoods, and it enables them to get some job in conditions which can be argued. But the government just doesn't want to act on that at all. Including in the post office, for instance, there is a terrible competition in France in the post office with various platforms, and the post office, using public capitals, is one of the first exploiters in France with subcontractors. There's going to be a trial which is going to open soon because there was one death because somebody died because he had no experience. And so, unfortunately, there must be a death before somebody reacts. And we have actually stressed that for the post office, but nobody cares.
trials are just being delayed and so on, except when a death occurs. I'm very pessimistic about the issues about the responsibility of the customers. I think that as long as there's going to be no delivery man who is going to be killed by a car or anything else, and the family goes to the criminal court for that, and nothing's going to change significantly. And as for the strikes from the customers, so, well, some people just hated that, but in the latest World Cup in France, there was some sort of an order saying don't ask for pizza being delivered by Deliveroo. And we have to take part into that, but with the means used by the young people, we have to use YouTube and so on, so as to increase awareness. And maybe an alternative could be to offer different fighting methods. I would nearly say that because the government cannot assume its responsibilities, maybe we have to find new forms to fight. Maybe hackers could explode the digital platform to teach them what it is. But I don't know. But I mean, we have to use our imagination. But, and my last thought, because of the local representative, local politician, we can still socialize costs while privatizing profits. In Grenoble, we have a system of bicycles which can be rented at very low costs. It's very efficient. We have more than 7,000 bicycles, and we can see that since we've had bicycle deliverer, we can see that about half of them use that metro bicycle. So basically, they use a public contract, and although they are individuals, and they use some public good to use for public economy, and there's no return in the economy. And the latest is that we've just had new electric bicycles, and we automatically improved the conditions of work of the deliverers. I hope you're going to put that in your realizations, in your successful realizations. And in fact, yes, well, thanks to us, they can deliver much faster and at a much easier pace.
I agree 100%
with what has been said by Pierre.
I created
the metro bikes in Grenoble in a previous mandate.
I'm going to
talk about exploiting even further, because I think that isn't it fair that for young people and students who need or feel they need to work for just a few hours, some of them have to in irregular hours because of their programs at universities and lectures and so on. Isn't it a global development of society which is part of what we want, a society which is more or less for free deliveries, free or cheap cost for taxis, for Uber taxis or Airbnb?
We, as a society,
have more or less subscriptions which are illimited, whether we talk about bikes, public transport, or telephones. We know in our society that we work less and less. So if we work for 40 hours a week, it is quite logical that we want to have regular hours. But if we only work 20 hours, so for for many people, it means it's not going to be very difficult to work once in the morning, once in the afternoon. Maybe we don't want regular hours anymore. Maybe it's a global development of society that tends to go to such flexible working systems and the internet, which enables to set up all those tools. In this development, which is actually happening, don't we actually leave big capitalistic societies, which are predators, get hold of such new possibilities, such envies of people? So smart experience is very important because it is a support, and we should not lose all that social aspect, security, contributions, and so on. I think we have to think about it, but widen and broaden the question. The last intervention, and I'm going to let them talk for 5 minutes.
Merci pour vos témoignages et bravo pour ce que vous faites. Ma question, elle est en fait assez simple, c'est est-ce qu'on est dans un changement de forme et une évolution avec le digital ou un changement de nature ? Je vais prendre deux exemples.
Nature or change in development.
Vous avez dit la question des notations. Finalement, est-ce que c'est juste une différence de nature que de noter les choses sur une plateforme digitale et de les faire en temps réel par rapport au guide Michelin qui décerne des étoiles et où on a dit pendant des années que ça pouvait faire la réussite ou la ruine d'un restaurateur,
and so on, to a restaurant, and so on.
You remember that chef who actually killed himself when he lost his star.
So one is a digital support, the other one is a paper support. So is it just a development in the situation? And today we have delivery today, but there used to be temporary agencies before, and when I was a student, I actually wrote to them, and I was actually working with logistic companies in the summer, or I would help with removals and so on. So it was pretty much the same as delivery. What is the difference, in fact, between what used to exist before and now the digital platform? Is it just a development in the form, or is it more deeper in the change, I mean?
Je vais essayer de me rappeler. Donc,
I'm going to try to think.
Les consommateurs, c'est ça la première question. Si that was the first question about the responsibility of the consumers. J'ai envie de dire partiellement oui.
I want to say yes in part because
it's sort of
you can join it with everything which is free. It's wonderful to have everything free, but when something is free, the question is who is paying?
Parce que ce n'est pas
because
gratuit.
Nothing is free.
Comme ce n'est pas un t-shirt à 9 euros ne coûte pas 9 euros.
A 9-euro t-shirt doesn't cost 9 euros.
So I think we have to put some truth back into the policy, and
it's the same with agriculture, and we have to be a little bit more honest in what we're actually doing. Yes, I would like to say that the consumers have a role to play, and we have a role to raise awareness.
Je ne pense pas que les solutions doivent être individuelles parce que les combats individual au quotidien sont individual nombreux et qu'on ne peut pas mettre les responsabilités en permanence sur l'individu en disant « Ah, mais vous n'avez qu'à manger bio, ah, vous n'avez qu'à pas aller chercher ». En fait, il y a des solutions collectives à trouver et à un moment donné, c'est pour ça qu'on a un gouvernement qui a une capacité à faire énormément de bien et qui a des capacités à faire
accompagner ce mouvement support et à nous écouter si on est suffisamment nombreux pour montrer qu'on est en recherche d'autres choses, enough, ça va showing them that we're looking for something else. It's going to happen. I'm not pessimistic enough yet to give up in this fight. Give up on this fight, and I want to create this energy. And what is fun, what is good with SMART is that we have a legal framework. We're limited, of course, but at the same time, we're creating create collectively something new, and we are being listened because we grow up, we bring many people together. I can't remember what I wanted to say, but it's in connection with something, with a question. There was a question about the artistic system, which costs a lot of money. Our project is expensive as well, but mutualized all the risks we do and assume the bankruptcy of a company and so on. It's expensive for the collectivity, but the whole collectivity, if the whole collectivity reinvests at the same level, then we can actually absorb the costs. If we take the concrete example of SMART, 20% of our of the basis of our members
et donc, du coup, has it that 100% of our members can benefit.
We could actually question all this, saying it's not fair for the 20%, but at the same time, when you look closer to it, it means that one of the members can be, during his career, part of those 20%. So do we have to make a difference when all of a sudden that same member belongs to the 80%? So we think that if we create some collective system, and if everybody contributes up to the capacities he or she is in, we can create something which is fairly strong and can absorb the costs, which are, can be quite high.
Then, so, I talked about, and the last question was about,
is it a development in, the, in its form or in nature? I feel like saying,
en tout cas, en fait, je vais revenir sur ce que j'ai déjà dit, c'est qu'on est en train d'appliquer des visions anciennes à des outils nouvelles. To modern tools, et ça crée un certain nombre de problèmes.
And that creates a certain amount of problems. You're talking about Marx. Marx have always existed in the enterprise, but it was not made public. It was not on the internet. It was not visible by everybody.
And still,
it was a human being deciding if you were good or not.
Now it's just people which are unknown,
and they're going to apply a mark, and
we're just being sort of small dictator.
We can decide whether the delivery man was doing his job in a good job, in a good way, whether the driver was good or fast enough, and so on. Many surveys show that it generates anxiety.
In
social cooling, for instance, is quite interesting. It is the anxiety of the young people who have grown up with the internet,
and they
are tense and anxious about doing certain things because they know it might be put out publicly.
And a self-management
is much stronger than before. So we're strengthening the systems we did not quite agree before,
and they're put on the public, they're put open to the public, and we use a sort of censorship on the youth people in their behavior. And I think that the youth has to be youth and young people, and if they want to drink a lot, they should be able to do it without it being a handicap in the rest of their career. So
I was given 5 minutes, so I'll stop here, but I'm around if you want to discuss over a glass of something. I'm here all day.
I'm going to focus a little bit on your question about ethical consumerism. And I won't fill 5 minutes with it, don't worry. Of course, it is always a good thing to watch on what way you consume things. For example, I will never use Uber or Deliveroo now that I know about it. I won't use it ever. And the same goes for a lot of things. But at the same time, there are people that need it. For example, they could be handicapped, and it could be difficult for them to go out to the grocery store or to a restaurant and have food. And maybe Deliveroo is the only service that services their area. Or, for example, with Uber, maybe they are the only way they can afford to get around. And I don't think that that should disqualify them from being critical to how these services work and how they treat their employees. For example, in the Netherlands, there is currently a debate going on about air traffic. There are a lot of people that just think that air traffic should not grow anymore in the entire country because we simply don't have the space for it. And the space that people, that politicians are making for it is costing a lot of, costing a lot in terms of public health, in terms of noise pollution. And they're often being criticized because these are the same people that will sometimes fly. And I don't think that should disqualify anyone's arguments. If one of you needs to use Uber or needs to use Deliveroo, that's fine. You can still agree to the problem of individualization of the labor market needs to be solved. That is everything I would like to add.
Je vais juste me permettre quelques mots de conclusion.
I just want to conclude in a few words. I think that if we were not convinced in the beginning, we are now convinced, and we, all the texts show us that there are segments of those new platforms offering a link between two individuals, or at least creates the illusions that it is. But in fact, there are traditional methods, and there are new laws exist, and words have to be requalified, and this is clearly happening in court. And we have to qualify the subordination link again, and that it's not a freelance contract, but a contract between employer and employee. And with Uber and Deliveroo, they are typical fights which the trade unions have always been fighting for. And we have to go over the startup and new words and whatever. But we also have new types of jobs that need to be adapted in the law and in the collaborative platforms, and we also have in the traditional system, in the traditional companies, we have trade unions doing something as well, or groups doing something. We were talking about new world and working less, and we are faced with such issues. In the journal, we have an interview of the chairman of the Confederation of German Trade Unions, and he's trying to explain how they try to adapt. And he recalls that collective negotiation, which took place not so long ago in the transport, in the field of transport in Germany. The first one entailed a small improvement in the wages, but also they negotiated again for an increase of 2.6% more holiday, a shorter working week, and the workers had the choice of what they wanted. So individually they chose, 56% chose more holiday, 42% wanted an increase in the wages, and a small percentage wanted to work less. And in fact, we need more individualization when the syndicate, when the trade unions negotiate. In Germany, it's a bit they're stronger. So it's an interesting example, and I really invite you into reading that journal. Working on those issues, and I would also like to have a political answer. That we have to reinvent a new workshop for that an MEP, a national member of parliament, can also that. There is a Danish MP who works on that, and a Green deputy, and she actually wanted to work on that and suggested new laws and so on. We see that there's also a big demand in collectivities. And I also wanted that there's a researcher here who, Pierre, started thinking that for the intermittent system, like the artists, could adapt, but how they could pay more. Do you want to add a little bit on that?
C'est une vraie piste de travail qui est en train d'être
réfléchie. It's really a new working path. Many people worked on the precarious artists who work from time to time.
And now they work on this type of contract,
which was a contract
which was, should not be seen as something expensive,
but something if society wanted to have neutral information and artists and so on, they would have to accept the cost. And there are also a whole amount of trades which are precarious trades by definition. But the activity is, by definition, irregular, and so the wages should not be seen as something smooth and so on, but and in which unemployment should be used to actually make that last from 1 month to another.
But the employers and trade unions
contribute twice as much, and that shouldn't be seen like that. You have to be very careful when you say that work is expensive.
Merci à tous. On a tous Thank été très, très courageux, je crois, les intervenants et vous. Je suis congelée,
speakers, mais
merci. Frozen. Je pense que vraiment, faut qu'on continue à travailler dessus. Merci and à Eliezer et Jess qui sont venus. On that.
Thank you to Eliezer and Jess who came.
So, I'm sorry I got...